All right, amen. Good to see you tonight. Glad you're back in the house of the Lord. Good to have Barris with us. Glad they're here. And my voice is out because I yelled all week at Gatlinburg at a basketball tournament. So anyway, it's getting better. And by Wednesday, it should be just right. It's always like this on the day after, or week after, let's say. But anyway, glad you're here. Got a good psalm tonight. We're going to do a 3D message. 3D message tonight, and goes along with the passage of scripture in Psalm 60. Interesting, you know, how this is the way it should be for us. The passage we're going to talk about, feeling deserted and then having delight and then being delivered. You know, we think it quite opposite. We think that, you know, when we feel deserted, then there ought to be deliverance, then delight, you know. But David, oftentimes in the Psalms, he's delighted before he ever receives a deliverance.
You're right.
That's the way we should be, shouldn't it? Trust God. Because you're just as good as delivered.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Even though you're not so-called delivered, right? Amen. In the situation you might be in. So anyway, looking forward to that, and glad you're here. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, grateful for who you are. Thank you for letting us be here. Thank you for giving us the health and the strength and the desire to want to be here. And we pray that you'd speak to our hearts. We thank you for the Barretts. Thank you for what they mean to us as a church. Continue to watch over them. Continue to help them to get everything done they need to get done before going back to Brazil. And we pray you'd give them wisdom and the financial support that they need. And again, we thank you for this dear family. We thank you for Faith Baptist Church, the families here. We pray, God, you'd speak to our hearts. And again, we want to pray for Ray Beal. We thank you for what you've already done there and not being a heart attack. And we pray to be able to come home from the hospital tonight and just get back safely to his home. Father, again, we ask that your will be done here tonight. Bless the choir singing, congregational singing, the preaching of thy word, any testimony that we might receive. Father, we pray to bring glory, honor, and praise to thee. For it's in Christ's name we pray. All God's people said,
amen. Amen.
Just
card comes down, please, and turn to page 575, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. Let's stand and sing all three verses, please, page 575.
Concerned about us, and you want the best for us, Lord. And Lord, we just ask that you might once again bless in the service tonight. Thank you for each and every one that's assembled here tonight, Lord. We thank you for the Barretts and their ministry there in Brazil, and we just ask you might ever have your hand of blessing on them, and be with our pastor tonight as he breaks the bread of life to us, and we study there in Psalms, and just give him the words that we need to hear, and may we take it in and receive it, and may it do the work that needs to be done in our hearts. And thank you once again for the Lord Jesus Christ and his death on Calvary's cross, and that precious blood that was shed for our sins. Amen. And we love you, Lord, and thank you for your love for us, and all these things we ask in Christ's name and for his sake. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, I talked to you this morning about that Sleep Number bed. So I said, well, I guess I'm going to check it out this afternoon and see how much one of those things cost. And the first thing that I saw was this, and told me that this was something I could not have. It said, you can get $1,000 off. And I said, okay, get $1,000 off, it must be pretty high. So anyway, for the high end, I think it's close to $4,000, you know. So that was a bad sign when it said you can get $1,000 off, because I was expecting to pay $1,000, right? So I said, man, I'm going to get this thing free some way or another. Didn't happen, right? But anyway, amen. Don't forget, this coming Saturday will be a work day at 9 o'clock, and we will work. We won't work until Jesus comes, but we will work until we get it done, all right? And we'll have lunch provided for you for that, and look forward to that, getting some things done around the church. There's a sign-up sheet in the back for that. If you would sign up there, that would be great. And then don't forget choir practice on the 17th, and then Easter is coming, and then we'll have an event down at Margaret's here soon as we get that date scheduled, and we'll decide what we're going to have there. Always a good time, good food, and good fellowship, and you're going to make us some jalapeno poppers, bacon wrapped, something like that. All right, good. So I'll be there. So you come too, all right? And if not, more jalapeno wrapped bacon cheese things for me, right? But anyway, man, looking forward to that. Also, glad you're here tonight, and look forward to God speaking to our hearts.
Let's take your handbooks once again, please, and turn to page 508, Love Lifted Me. Let's stand and sing all three verses, please, page 508.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Very deeply sank within, seeking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me.
Markel, Dalton's friend there, lives with him, right? And Markel texted me this week at Gatlinburg and asked for prayer. And so that was a blessing, amen. Surprise there. And so that was good. Just pray God to continue to work in his heart and his life and help him in his needs. There, if you would, continue to pray for Daryl as we take him tomorrow with his leg. Suzanne, lift her up in her difficulties. Anna Martin, continue to pray as she continues to heal. And continue to pray for this lady that will have surgery on the 27th, Carol Newland. I pray for her. She has this mass removed. And do pray for Cindy Presnell, Barbara Marley's daughter. And as I mentioned to you this morning, they're praying that either, you know, God's will be done, of course, that God will take her on home and be with the Lord, or he'll heal her and touch her. And she's back on these respirators and these tubes to keep her breathing. And so just pray for her, if you would. Of course, pray for all these on our prayer list that don't know the Savior. Pray God would speak to their hearts and that they'd be saved before it's eternally too late. Many people with cancer, I believe Randy Holt had to have some fluid removed from his leg. And so pray for him, if you would. And of course, the whole family with Sam's cancer and his cancer and just all that. You know, it's just so, you know, it's got to be taxing and hard, you know, but the Lord's good and the Lord can take care of him, but we need to pray for him. Amen. Continue to pray for Hannah. Continue to lift her up and the baby. Just continue to pray there for them, and pray God will continue to watch over them, if you would. Excuse me. Mike Gardner's going to have surgery on his left wrist. Pray for him. Susan's going to have knee replacement, so lift her up. And then Fisher is going to have some surgery on his cleft palate. Josh Wagar, lift him up. And Sarah and the family there, pray God will just watch over them. Pray whatever we might be able to do to help them out some financially. And aren't you glad God has blessed us financially? Amen. And that we can help other people out when they have need. What a blessing that is. You know, you're not always in that kind of situation. You know, you might want to help, but you can't help because you don't have the finances to do it. We here at Faith Baptist Church, God has blessed us tremendously, and we can help people out. Amen. And that's a blessing to be able to do that, right? Amen. One day we might have need. We might have to call on somebody to help us, right? And so praise God that we're able to do that. What a blessing that is. Do pray. We're going to try to get everything formulated with the fellowship hall and the bathroom and all that, to get all that working in the right direction. I believe we're going in the right direction by getting Brother Barney and his brother-in-law to do it. I got another price from the other company that I asked to do give us a price. And so anyway, I think the best route is for them to do it. And of course, they've done it plenty of times before. It's not like they're amateurs or anything like that. So anyway, just to pray we'll get all that lined up and get her ready to get done. So I need some of you young men, okay, some of you young men, and maybe even some of you middle-aged men. We're going to have a day, a demolition day. We're going to go back to your childhood when you like to tear things up. And so we're going to rip up that carpet back there, get it out, and get the baseboard out and all that stuff. And because that's going to save us some money too and save them some time, okay? Got some volunteers out there. I see y'all. Amen. Hey, they're raising their hands up. That's good, good, good. All right. All right, I'll leave it to you guys. I'll let you know what I want done. I'm going to be a delegator. But anyway, pray about that. Pray we'll be able to get all that situated. And they tell us, man, my first bait back to the chicken house is tomorrow. It's supposed to be 31, 32 degrees in the morning. Y'all believe that? And but anyway, the rest of the week's good, so I don't need to be complaining to it. The rest of the week's going to be, looks like, high 30s and low 40s. And so, anyway, any other prayer requests? Yes, sir.
Remember the Beulah Hicks family?
Okay.
Miss Beulah passed away this morning. I think she was 96 about a month ago.
Oh, wow. Okay. Beulah Hicks family. All right, let's certainly pray for that family there. Now, that's David's mom, right?
Yeah, David Hicks' mother.
All right. Okay, all right. Kendall get back safely?
Yeah.
All right, praise God for that. I told Kendall she just needs to stay here in God's country with us. Mm-hmm. She said no. Any others? Yes, sir.
We have two ladies there at Sloan, and they both have cancer.
Oh, really? Okay.
And so.
Okay, let's pray for these two ladies at Sloan Homes that have cancer.
One's Anna and the other's Gwen. Two
Anna.
Missionary wives. One is named Anna. They were missionaries for many years. They're in the military, but they're missionaries in China.
Okay.
And she actually teaches English and then witnesses to people there in China. Okay. She has cancer. She's going through cancer treatment. And another one called Gwen,
Gwen.
They were missionaries for many years in Spain. They actually moved out of Salon yesterday. We helped them with the move. Mm-hmm. But they also are very, she's very sick.
Okay.
We'll have to start treatment.
Okay. All right, let's pray for Anna and Gwen with this cancer there. Salon Homes, lift them up to the Lord in prayer. If you would, a lot of cancer yeah. going on. Lots and lots and lots. Anybody else? Yes.
I saw Jenny Milgar at the Walmart before we left. It was, mm-hmm. I think, the week before we went to Gatlinburg. And she was with Betsy and invited her to church. And she has a phone now, so I'm really hoping to be able to communicate with her and maybe she can come back to church. And then also Cookie, this was Claudia and Angel's daughter. Mm-hmm. She's working at
Sonic
now. So I invited her. She's almost 20 now. Mm. So just pray for those.
Sure. All right. Let's certainly pray for Jenny and Cookie and Betsy. Lift them up to the Lord in prayer. Well, we're getting older, aren't we? We talk about these kids getting older, but we're getting older too, aren't we? And boy. Any others? Yes, sir.
For Alini's documentation, we're still waiting on that. The last update was that we sent in her medical reports and things that they requested. And they updated about 2 weeks ago now. They updated on their site that they received it and they are working on her case again. Whatever that means. But we really, God knows the desire of our hearts.
Sure.
We would really like it to be ready by the end of this month. Mm-hmm. So we would be able to purchase the tickets and then leave in April.
Right, sure.
April the 10th was the date that we were planning if her paperwork would be approved in time.
Okay.
We talked at Salome. They said that we could stay longer if needed. So we were really happy about that because our date to leave was April the 14th.
Right.
So, but you know, we wish we wouldn't have to use that,
right.
That we could be able to get back to Brazil. And we're, you know, our hearts are aching for that. We're really looking forward to it. So
sure.
Please pray that her documentation can be approved soon.
All right. Let's certainly pray for Alini's documentation. Pray that that'll get all settled and they'll be able to get over there to Brazil and do
yes,
the work
sir.
God's called them to do.
Amen.
Amen. Anybody else? All right. David, why don't you pray for us, please, sir, if you would.
Dear Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you, dear Lord, for your so many blessings to us. You've been so, so wonderful and so kind to us in so many different areas of our lives. You have blessed us physically, financially, spiritually, dear Lord, just so many blessings that we can't even measure, Father. And more than anything, dear Lord, that we have eternal life, that we have assurance of that too, not just eternal life, but that assurance. That blessed assurance that you give us, and that we know that we will one day live in heaven for all eternity. Dear Lord, I pray for these different prayer requests. I will not remember all the names, dear Lord,
sure,
and I'm not
sure.
even going to try to
sure.
read all the names, but I will remember some specific ones. I know there are several that will be going through surgeries,
mm-hmm.
Hip and wrist surgeries and other different surgeries. Father, you know them.
Mm-hmm.
You know which ones I'm talking about that were mentioned tonight. And
sure.
I pray that you could help them, help these families as they prepare for these surgeries. And it's not easy, dear Lord. Many times that we don't think much about a surgery until we have to go through one.
Sure.
And then we want people to pray for us. And please help us to remember to pray for them. You can encourage their hearts and help them through that. I pray for ones that have lost family members
mm-hmm.
and are hurting. That you could comfort their hearts, that you could help them through that, dear Lord. Give them the grace that only you can give, Father, and the help that only you can give. I know how, firsthand, how your grace carried us through my dad's death and other deaths in our family, and I pray that you could comfort their hearts. Dear Lord, I pray for the ones with cancer, the ones that we have had a lot of contact recently, Anna and Gwen and some others that were mentioned tonight, dear Lord. I pray that you could help them through this treatment, strengthen their bodies as they have to go through many times chemo and other things, and that roller coaster, that up and down, that's so hard for them, dear Lord. I pray that you could just help them through that, carry them through that, give them the grace to go through this this difficult time, them and their families. Pray for the ones that have strayed away from the Lord, even Mrs. Shutt mentioned some that she met, Jenny and Cookie and, and Betsy and others, dear Lord, that you could work in their hearts, that they could come back to you, dear Lord, and come back to serving the Lord, and that you could do a great work in their lives, I pray. Lord, I pray for the Beulah Hicks family and the passing of their family member, that you could also comfort them and help them. Hannah with the baby, dear Lord, just some prayer requests that I mentioned. Daryl, I don't know if he's have surgery on his leg or exactly what he has to do about his leg, but you could touch him and help him with that, dear Lord. And Martell, that you could continue working in his life, dear Lord. And Ray Bill, and other ones, Father, that that are hurting, that need your help, dear Lord. I pray also for the work that will be done in the church. I know that it's an exciting time to go through renovations, but it's also can be a stressful time, Father. Sure. And I pray that you could just direct and help, even with wisdom as far as pricing and and who can do what, and strength, dear Lord, to go through all of that.
Please
help Pastor Shutt and the church family here and encourage their hearts. Pray for lost souls, dear Lord. We have so many lost family members, lost friends. Please help us, dear Lord, to have a love for lost souls. Help us to look for opportunities, dear Lord, that we can witness. And many times, I apologize, dear Lord, many times I miss opportunities that I could have taken advantage of. And please help us to have a love for souls and a concern for them, dear Lord, I pray. And I pray for the continuation of this service. Dear Father, bless Pastor Shutt, help him, fill him with your Holy Spirit, that he would say only the things that you would want him to say, Father. Put the words in his mouth. And that we may be edified, dear Lord, not only hearers of the word, but doers, dear Lord. And you know, many times we say, oh, I love you, Lord. And I do want to express that with my words, dear Lord, that I love you. But your word says that if you love me, keep my commandments.
Right.
And I want to keep your commandments, not just say it with my mouth, but live it with my life.
Right.
And I pray that you could bless this ministry, bless Faith Baptist Church. Father, thank you for the blessing that they have been in our lives. They've already been such an encouragement and such a blessing in just this actually short time that we've known them, and we appreciate the way you've connected us. And I pray that you could greatly use this ministry, continue using this ministry greatly through the years, and as we go back to Brazil, that we're looking forward, dear Lord, to seeing what wonderful things that you will do through even our partnership and through the partnership that they have with so many other missionaries around the world. We thank the Lord for them. Bless each and every one here this evening. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Appreciate that, my brother. I was thinking about that, you know, when it comes to missionaries and pastors, we talk to different people. I'm trying to think where I'm supposed to preach out of. Psalm 60, you know, one of the things that really should shine forth in a pastor or a missionary or a Christian in general is humility. Amen. I appreciate David's humility and his willingness, again, to, you heard his prayer. We all fail to be a witness the way that we should be. We all fail in our love for God the way it should be. Obviously, we should love God more than we love anybody else. And but oftentimes, that's not what happens. And I was reminded of one of my favorite preachers, Ian Thomas. You know, and I've said this to you before, and this is so important to remember. I'm an imperfect got that already. I'm an imperfect preacher or pastor preaching a perfect book.
Amen.
Perfect book, amen, to imperfect people, right?
Yes,
to perfect them. And that's one of, you know, I like good, solid nuggets that you can hang on to for life. And that is one. And we got to always remember that. You always got to remember that I'm imperfect, right? Amen. You said, well, we sure do know that. So you ain't got to tell us again. And I got to remember that you're imperfect, right? And I got to remember that God is perfect.
Amen.
And he's given us a perfect book. Amen. And he desires, according to Matthew chapter 5 and verse 48, that he says that we're to be perfect, just as your Father in heaven is perfect.
Yeah.
And of course, we know, again, he's perfecting us, and we're never going to be perfect or totally mature the way that we should be until we go to be with him.
Yeah.
And so we need to be reminded of that. We need to think about all the blessings that we have here, and to be able to experience, you know, I know, trust me, there are discouragements, there are disappointments, there are times where you feel deserted, and all those things, and but we need to read the Psalms, and we need to keep preaching the Psalms, and we need to understand that there one day, we're going to be perfectly delivered, amen, from this world and the sin and all the different things, and we're going to be rejoicing in that, amen, and we all look forward to that day, amen. Now, I understand it's hard, it's not easy, it's difficult, and but we need to trust God in this. This particular psalm, you know, a lot of these psalms have headings in front of them, and this is the longest heading that any of the psalms have. And you can go back and do this later. We're not going to do it tonight, but you can. It tells us there in the very beginning of the psalm. Yours might say this, it might not, but it says David prays for Israel's deliverance. It says to the chief musician upon the Shushan Edith, Mitchum of David, to teach when he strove with Amnurham and with Amran Zobah, when Joab returned and smote of Edom in the valley of Salt 12,000. And so if you want to know where this is taking place, you can go back to 2 Samuel chapter 8 and 2 Samuel chapter 10, and you can see there where this is what he's talking about there. Or you can go to 1 Chronicles chapter 18 and 1 Chronicles chapter 19. And this is the background and the scenery, the context of the psalm. And so evidently, again, God has allowed David again. He allowed this oftentimes in David's life to, for the most part, he won all the victories, but there was times where it seemed like they were going to lose, and they were losing, and some bad things happened. And so at the beginning of this psalm, verses 1 through 5, you're going to see David again, and not just David, but David was a representation of his people. Amen. And folks, listen, there's a connection there. You know, there's nothing wrong with having a connection with your country.
Yeah.
Amen. But don't let the connection with your country take away from your connection with the kingdom and the king.
Yeah.
Amen. So we can get so die hard, you know. And I was growing up, people say, you know, different things. You know, when I'm a sports person, and they said, man, I'd root for the Russians, you know, back in the day in the Cold War and all that. I'd root for the Russians if they were playing against Carolina. Yeah, you know, people would make statements like that. Now, listen to me. You would not root for the Russians, or at least I hope you would root for the Russians when they were playing against Carolina, you know, but you might. So anyway, but we make these statements, you know, these crazy statements and all those things, and we get it, and it causes us when countries like Iran and Iraq and these different places that are wicked and they have dictators and they're just mean-spirited, and they kill people, and it causes a hatred in our heart, and we need to be careful with that, amen, because these people need to be saved,
amen,
just as well as you and I need to be saved, amen. And so, again, there's this, you know, balance there, so in verses 1 through 5, there's this feeling, again, now listen to me, let me say this to you again, folks. We often think sometimes that feelings aren't real. Feelings are real.
Yeah.
Feelings are real. You know that, but you can't live by your feelings.
Yes.
Okay, but they are real, you know. And thoughts that come into our minds, you know. You can't just go, oh, I didn't think that. Well, yeah, you did think that. And but ultimately it's in the life of a believer, in the life of a Christian. And in the life of David, in the life of a country, it's exercising our will to choose God over our thoughts and our feelings. Amen? And so here we have in the first five verses this sense of desertion. You know, you feel like God is not doing what God said he would do. That's difficult. That's hard. But then in verses 6 through 8, you have, delight. David chooses again to delight in God and what God is going to do and has done. And then you have in verses 9 through 12, David's assurance of deliverance, that God is going to deliver. Amen?
Yeah.
Now, folks, listen, this is not the way it works with us. Mm-hmm. You know, we want deliverance first before delight. Now, come on, you're with me now. Everybody likes, you know, y'all like victory first, right? All of us do. But that's not the way it works oftentimes. We have to believe and trust God.
Yeah.
Sue sent me a couple scriptures out of Lamentations that she enjoyed reading today. And I enjoyed reading them too. And it said, it talked about us waiting, amen, waiting on the Lord. And God's people need to wait for his salvation and wait for his deliverance. Now, oftentimes in the scriptures, this word deliverance or salvation is, that's what it means, deliverance. It's not talking about your salvation as far as being saved from sin. It's talking about your ultimate deliverance and being delivered from the enemy and those kind of things. And again, praise God again. And I never get tired of telling you the same things over and over again. You know why? Because the Bible tells you the same things over and over again. Amen?
Amen.
When God saved us, amen, he saved us, praise God, from the penalty of sin. Amen. Why, isn't that wonderful? Praise God.
Amen.
And then God also saved us from the power of sin.
Yeah.
Amen. Sin shall not have dominion over you and me. Amen. But one day, praise God, and this ought to make somebody run in here, and God's going to save us from the very presence of sin. Amen. Now, I'm going to tell you, folks, sin is all around us, you know, and we battle it ourselves. And we have an old sin nature, and we need God to help us, and we need to think right. And we're not always going to think right. And we need to feel right. And we're not always going to feel right. But you know what we can do? We can always trust God and do right.
Yep.
Even in the midst of our feelings and our thoughts. So let's look at the passage of Scripture. God's going to help us with it tonight as we go through it. First of all, David says in verse number 1, he says, "Oh God, thou hast cast us off." Oh God, thou hast cast us off. Now, can I ask you a question? Did God cast them off? No. No. But there's a feeling here because, you know, listen, folks, listen. Everybody wants to win. Right? Everybody wants to have victory. Now, you do have victory in Christ.
Yeah.
But oftentimes you don't feel like you have victory. Oftentimes your thoughts mess with you, right? In your life. And you have to understand that we all go through this. Amen? So, again, what I love about the scriptures is the men and women of the Bible were just like you and me.
Yeah.
They're no different. These are not superheroes. This is not, one of them's called Marvel. What's the other one called?
DC.
This is not Marvel in DC. This is not Captain America and Thor, you know, all these things. No, this is reality. Amen. These are human beings that need to trust God like you and I need to trust God. Amen. That's why I chuckle. Y'all ever chuckle? Mm-hmm. Can we still use that word today? I chuckle at men that say men wrote the Bible. Mm-hmm. That makes me chuckle. You listen to me. Men didn't write the Bible. God wrote the Bible.
Yeah.
And we know that because God told us that. But another way we can know that is these men being honest about themselves. Nobody likes to tell. Have you read the Psalms about David? God says David was a man after God's own heart. But you read these Psalms, you see ups and downs. And that man was on a roller coaster ride in his emotions and his thoughts and his feelings. Am I telling you the truth?
Yeah.
Well, sure I am. That's what the Bible says. And so it's an honest book. And it's an honest look at man. But you know what? Greater than that, it's an honest look at God and who God is.
Amen.
Praise God for that. And so David says here, he says God, and notice what he uses there, God Almighty. Amen.
Yeah.
All-powerful one, right? The one that can deliver. Thou hast cast us off. Thou hast scattered us. Thou hast been displeased. Oh, turn thyself to us again. You know, when you're down and out, you're defeated, and you feel deserted, you know, and you're being, you feel like God has left you. I'll tell you, the best place to turn is to God. But notice this, he said, oh, turn thyself to us again. Amen? Right? You remember, Joshua, you know, saw the Lord there with the sword, and he said, who are you for? He said, for us or you for them? He said, neither. God is for himself. And folks, listen, now I know, listen, if you're on God's side, God's on your side and all that, but I'm telling you, God's on his side. Amen. God's going to do what he's going to do. Amen. And you and I need to get on board, amen, with God and what God is doing. And we need to trust him. He says, in this time, in this prayer of feeling and the thought of desertion, he says, God, turn yourself to us again. Boy, do we not need that in the United States of America, right? And I'm not talking about the country in itself. I'm talking about in the churches of the United States of America. We need God to turn himself back to us. And we need to turn ourselves to him. Yeah. And notice what he says here. And this is, again, I've told you this before. You need to use your sanctified imagination. And you need to see these terms that the Bible is using here of the feelings that the people had. Okay? Notice what he says in verse 2. He said, thou hast made the earth to tremble. You see, that's the way they felt it in their being. It's like an earthquake. He said, thou hast broken it. He said, heal the breaches thereof, for it shaketh or trembleth. You know, everything around seemed like an earthquake. Everything was going awry here. And so David says, this is, again, the way that they felt. You ever felt that way? You ever had a tremor or an earthquake in your feelings? Mm-hmm. Right? Here we are. Notice what else he says in verse 3. He said, thou hast showed thy people hard things. Now, folks, listen, I said to you this morning, we're too soft. As Christians, well, I said the basketball team was, but we are too. And we want everything. I read in the Sunday school open assembly, Amos chapter 6. You know, we're at ease in Zion. We're lying on ivory beds. You know, we want to, when it comes to spirituality, we want to sleep comfortably. No, the Bible says we need to continue to watch and pray. We need to know that the enemy is out there and he's aiming to destroy. The Bible says that the devil has come to seek and destroy. Right? He's walking about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And that word in there means to gulp down completely. He wants to devour you and me. Now, praise be to God that God is our protector, amen? Amen. And he's watching over us. But it's not just, again, just saying Jesus' name. You need to be in Jesus' name. You need to be walking with God under the protection in the perfect will of God, walking with God, doing what God would have you to do, amen?
Yeah.
And so David says, he says, boy, you showed your people hard things. You know, when you're losing and you're not sensing the victory, you know, you feel like, you know, this is too hard. You know, but you got to remember the Bible again. There's no temptation that's taken you, but such is common to man, right? But God is faithful, right?
Yeah.
Listen, God is faithful. You and I are not always faithful, but God is always faithful.
Yes.
Who will not tempt you or bring a trial in your life. Greater than you can bear. That's what the Bible says. But will, again, with the temptation. Now, he ain't going to exclude it, but with the temptation, he'll give you a way of escape. Amen? God, and you know this, who the escape is? God. Yeah. The Lord Jesus Christ. The Spirit of God. The Word of God. And so David says here, he said, you show your people hard things. He said, thou hast made us to drink the wine of astonishment. You know, it's like they're staggering around. They're in unbelief that they could lose a battle. And what I tell you, folks, listen, in your own strength and when you do things your own way, and oftentimes, listen, God allows us to lose even when we may be doing the right thing. Yeah. Y'all know that, right? That sometimes when you do right, you get persecuted.
True.
Sometimes when you do the right thing, you know, what you thought the result might be, you know, might not be the result that you know why? Because somebody on the other end has to respond. You may respond in the right way. You may do all the right things. And you say, well, God, I thought you was going to work this out. Well, you thought he was going to work it out the way you thought he was going to work it out. Right? Now, people ought to respond in the right way when we respond rightly, right? But they don't always do that, do they? And so we got to ask God to help us with that. And so he said, here they are. They're teetering, tottering. It's like an earthquake, and things are shaking. And he says in verse 4, he said, thou hast given a banner to them that fear thee, that it may be displayed because of the truth. You know, the Bible says his banner over me is love. Amen. And all through the scriptures, they talk about the different tribes having this standard, you know, this banner. And boy, oh boy, our banner as Christians is God. Amen. He's the one that we uphold. God, amen. We uplift him. Now, he upholds all things, but we lift him up, amen. And he is our banner. He is over us, and we need to think about that. And in verse 5, he says, that thy beloved may be delivered, save with thy right hand, and hear me. Amen. Now, you know, again, we've talked about this many a time before. What is the right hand? Right hand is whenever the right hand is missing, it's power. Now, if you're left-handed, don't get offended. Okay. So, the Bible doesn't say, David, the left hand of power. Right? Pardon my pun. But you know what? Do you know who's seated at the right hand of the Father?
Amen.
The Lord Jesus. You know, the Bible says there's joy and rejoicing at the right hand of the Father also. Pleasure forevermore. Jesus is there.
Yes.
He is, again, Jesus is, quote unquote, God's right hand. Amen. He's the right hand of power. And David says, again, now folks, listen. When you're in desperation and you feel deserted, okay, you need to know that God or somebody, ultimately God, hears you.
Yeah.
Right? Come on, folks. Mm-hmm. Now, David's just like you and me. He's feeling as if, God, you've left us alone. You've cast us off. Right? We've been here before, haven't we? And David's praying and he's saying, God, hear me. There is just something about, now folks, I've said this to you before because it's true, men and preachers. Now, you don't have, now you do have, but you shouldn't have women preachers. Nobody said amen right there. I'll say it. Amen. The Bible, again, there's not women preachers.
Yeah.
Okay? Men are the ones that have been called into leadership. Now, folks, you need to read the Bible, study the Bible. I'm not against women.
Yeah.
And the Bible's not against women. God made women. Amen. Okay? But, you know, it's a bad combination. Because, you know, number one, men are bad listeners. They're bad listeners. Is that not the truth? We're not very good listeners. Now, there might be some women out there not good listeners, and you might be one of them. I don't know. But anyway, and then we're preachers. You know, preachers are bad listeners. It's like God gave us a double-edged sword. So you know what that means that I have to do as a man and as a preacher, pastor? I gotta depend on God. I gotta ask God to help me.
Yeah.
I gotta be a better listener. Amen.
Yeah.
Now, folks, don't you? Now, you men in here that you may not be a preacher, but I know you need help listening. Because you're a man. Right? And so When you read the scriptures, that being a good listener is so important. It's not the words that you might give out. It's hard. It's not easy peasy pie in the sky stuff. Right? People like to be heard.
Yeah.
Like to be heard. And you know, when you're a meditator, that's another thing that's against you. Now, meditation is good, but when you got all these thoughts running through your mind and you're a fixer, men are usually fixers, right? Are y'all with me? And you know, and David, he's really showing himself as a man. You know, he says, God, hear me and fix it right now. I need it now. I need it done. Right? And so again, this idea, we need to understand that, you know, when you're in desperation and you feel like you're deserted, you just want to be comforted. You want to be heard. You want God to, you know, God, would you hear me? Amen. Now again, we went through this word with the young adults meditation, and you know, folks, listen, I might forget things and go back, but you know that word there, meditation, and not just in the Psalms, but the word that's the Hebrew word has the idea to talk to yourself. But you know what I noticed? Also, talk to yourself out loud. You imagine that, walking around, and you're just talking to yourself out loud and say, hey, who are you talking to? I'm talking to me. You think how many people are going to hang around you. Hey, that would be a good way to get rid of some people. Just kidding. And why does he say that, though? Because oftentimes, when you're just talking to yourself mentally, you can't really get it expressed right. But you start talking out loud, those words, you start not only talking them, but you're hearing them back to yourself. Amen? And so David here, again, folks, he's doing the right thing. He's in desperation. He's feeling deserted, and he's turning to God. He's wanting God to turn to him, and he's talking to God, and he wants God to hear him. Amen? Deliver him. So he says, deliver me, save me with thy right hand, and hear me. And then verse 6 through 8 is so interesting because, you know, before, you know, he ever gets delivered from this, and you can go back and read, what a great deliverance. What a great victory God gave with Joab and I think it's Abishai. But anyway, go back and read that in 2 Samuel 8 and 2 Samuel 10 and 1 Chronicles 18 and 1 Chronicles 19 is the same thing as 2 Samuel 8 and 2 Samuel 10. They're the same, dealing with the same subject there. It's the same scenery. It's the same context. And so go back and read that and see the great victory that God gave David. And really, it was talking about how God was building God. How God was building David up in front of the people.
Yeah.
Amen? Mm-hmm. And the people had to have a respect for David because of God. Amen? Yeah. That's what God was doing and making him be honored. And by the way, folks, you'd rather God honor you than you honor yourself.
Oh, yeah.
Amen?
True.
And so don't put yourself on a pedestal. Don't put yourself out there. Don't try to be, you know, this person that you're not. Just let God be God and let him put you where he wants you. Amen? Mm-hmm. And appreciate that. And so here, excuse me, in verse 6, David is going to delight before the deliverance. So we see the feeling and the thoughts of desertion. And now, you know what we're going to see? We're going to see the feeling and the thoughts of delight, you know, before the feeling and the thought of deliverance. Amen. Before he ever is delivered. Notice what he says here. He said, God has spoken. Amen. Now listen to me, folks. God has spoken. And God is still speaking. Yeah. Amen. And we can trust God. Amen. Yeah. God has spoken. Listen. In his holiness, okay? Now, this word holy, again, it does mean to be pure, and but it's separation, it's other, you know? There's nobody like God, amen? He's other. He has spoken in his separatistness, his holiness, and this is what David says, and I love this, folks. You see, folks, this is all through the scriptures, you're going to find it. Now, if you don't find this, then let's talk. Let's come back and let's have a talk and have a chat. You know, we can even have tea. As a matter of fact, we have some Brazilian coffee that they brought us. Okay? have a little coffee together and we can have a chat.
You'll stay up very late, though.
I will.
Yeah, if you drink Brazilian coffee.
Well, amen. I want to stay up late tonight. I want to be like the psalmist in Psalm 119 where he said, my eyes prevent the night watches because I meditate upon thy word. Mm-hmm. I asked the young adults, I said, what keeps you up at night? Meditating on God's word? Probably not. Right? But hey, we can talk about this, but notice, folks, do you see, if you cannot see the change and the transition, something's wrong. You see, we have thoughts and feelings of desertion. But then we have, in verse 6, a transition of choice.
Yeah.
He's not talking about, now folks, listen. He still had them feelings of thoughts of desertion and they're not good. They're like an earthquake. There's tremors going on. It's like a man drinking wine, staggering around in the streets, you know, feel like, hey man, nothing's going right. But David says, God, you've spoken in your holiness. I will rejoice.
Yeah.
Do you see that, folks? Rejoicing is a choice. Amen. You can choose to rejoice even in the situation that you might be in. And folks, that's what we got to do. I'm going to tell you what, folks, listen, we're not going to make it. We're not going to make it if we don't rejoice. Yeah. Even in the bad times that we go through, in the times of feeling of being deserted, we're not going to make it. I'm just telling you, we're not going to. David said, God, you've spoken in your holiness. He said, I will rejoice. I will divide Shechem and meet out the valley of Succoth. He says, he's speaking of the Lord and himself here. He says, I will divide Shechem and meet out the valley of Succoth. Gilead is mine. Manasseh is mine. Ephraim also is the strength of mine head. He said, Judah is my lawgiver. Moab is my washpot. Over Edom will I cast out my shoe. Philistia, triumph thou because of me. God is in control. Amen.
Amen.
We need a message from God that God is delights in protecting us and watching over us, and we need to rejoice in that ourselves. That God wants to bring us out of the feelings of desertion. God wants us to know that He is watching over us, and He wants us to have the delight because He delights to do what He does for us.
Yeah.
Amen. Aren't you glad that God delights to protect you and to watch over you? Now, again, it doesn't mean that you don't have your part. You know, there's a lot of scriptures. You know, I was thinking about this passage of scripture, and I was thinking about, what's those two guys' names? Y'all help me out. Y'all don't even know what I'm talking about. Anyway, Moses is up there on the mount, and Joshua is down there fighting the battle, and Aaron and Hur are up there holding up Moses' hands, you know, and when his hands began to come down, was it the Ammonites? I can't remember who it was he was fighting there, down there, and who was it?
Amalekites.
I knew it started with an A, thank you. The Amalekites, the Ammonites are when you go back to 2 Samuel chapter 8 and all that. But anyway, and so, again, there's a role and there's a part that we play. Amen. But it's ultimately God that gives the victory. Amen. Yeah. Now, folks, listen, there's no way possible that you're going to understand all that and the sovereignty of God and how God uses free choice in the choices and the prayers and the thing. I do not know how God works all that out.
Yeah.
But I tell you what, I can't figure it out. I'm never going to figure it out. Why am I trying to figure it out? Why don't I just do what God says?
Yeah.
Amen. And why don't I just delight in God? That God desires, and He says, all these people are nothing. He said, the nations are a drop in the bucket. Amen. He's in control of all these things. You see, He says, Moab is my washpot. He said, you know, they ain't good for nothing but feet washing. Edom will I cast out with my shoe. Same thing. Philistia, triumph thou because of me. Listen, there's no nation, folks. There's nobody that rises to power without God's consent. Y'all realize that, right?
Yeah.
Now, see, for us, we're like, God, why do you do this? Now, I don't know why God does it. I don't know why God allows it. But he does allow dictators to rise. He allows all these different things. But listen, all dictators are going to fall.
Yeah.
One day, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords is going to reign. Amen. He's going to rule over all the world. Amen. We're going to rule with him. Praise God. What a day that's going to be. Boy, I tell you again, talking to different people up in Gatlinburg, people that I've been around for years, but never really had to talk to them. I talked to this father of a child that's playing ball up there, and he had a child that graduated last year and found out his background and he was poor. I mean, you know, I remember Ann telling us how poor she grew up. This man, how he grew up, he said, man, there was times that he had one meal. Now, you know, listen to this. You think you're poor. The man said, I'd have one roll and some butter. That was my supper. And I believe he was adopted, and he married a lady that was adopted. And his grandmother had given him a Bible. And I think he said when he was 12 years old, he began to read that Bible and read through that Bible, and he trusted Christ as Savior.
Amen.
Now, he went astray from God. But you know what he told me? He said, God's so good with all this. He said that he deserted God. He said, I went away from God. He said, but you know what? God never deserted me. He said, God was always with me, even though in the decisions I was making. And he said, I finally came to the conclusion when God was talking to me. He said, what are you doing? You have seen that all these things and all the things you've been running after hadn't been a thing, done anything for you. He says, you need to come on back to me. And he said, that's what he did. And what a blessing to hear his testimony. And you know what his testimony was? His testimony was God's faithfulness. That's what it was. It wasn't a testimony of his faithfulness because he wasn't faithful. It was a testimony of God's faithfulness. Amen. God is faithful. God is the owner of it all. God is in control. Amen. No matter what we might see, no matter what we might think, God is still in control. Amen. He's sovereign. We need to understand that he may allow something. Now, folks, obviously he's allowing some things in the United States of America we don't understand. But you know what? Got to trust him. Amen. God is in control. And this may, hey, you know what, folks? Listen, this might be the end of the end. Yeah. But you know, the end of the end is not the end of the end for us. No. Amen. Man, it's glory time. Amen. It's God setting up his kingdom and all the different things, the different dispensations. Now, I know there's people who don't believe in dispensations and all that, and that's okay. I'm not arguing and fussing with them. You know, that's okay. You believe what you want to believe, right? That's your choice. And I'm not saying, hey, they may be right. I don't believe they are. But anyway, God help us. But we do know that Jesus is coming soon, amen? And Jesus is coming back, and he's going to set up his kingdom, and we need to be excited about that. And that nobody rises without God allowing to rise. But we do know this, one day they're going to fall. Mm-hmm. All the kingdoms are going to fall. There's just going to be one kingdom,
yeah.
Amen? And so David delights in God. He delights in who God is. And God tells him who he is and what he's going to do. And then in verses 9 through 12, David begins to question and understand where his deliverance comes from. Now, folks, listen. Well, let's get to that in just a minute. David says, who will bring me into the strong city? Who will lead me into Edom? Who's going to take care of this? Edom has just won a victory, and they're feeling strong. They're feeling like, hey, and God's people are feeling weak, and they're feeling like, hey, this is not going to work out, and all these other kind of things. And again, this is a togetherness, and David has gone to God on behalf of the people, amen. He's the representative of them. And he says, who's going to deliver? Who's going to bring me into the strong city? Who will lead me into Edom? And then he says this in verse 10. He said, Wilt not thou, O God, which has cast us off? The very one the feeling of desertion, aren't you the one? Are you not the one that's going to deliver us? He said, and thou, O God, which didst not go out with our armies. He said, give us help from trouble, for vain is the help of man.
So true.
Now, folks, man can do a lot, but man cannot deliver like God can.
No.
Now, here's the thing. We're not God. And you would think that the judgment of God would be worse on David when he committed adultery and murder. You would think that that would be the worst thing you could possibly do, right? You remember what I said to you this morning? You name the five worst sins, you know, and we got this and this and this. And I told you this morning that unbelief is the worst sin. I told you that rebellion is one of the top five sins. Did I not? Well, I told you what the Bible said, right? But boy, it was really the numbering of the people. Like, huh? Why would that be, David? You know, David started numbering the people, you know. You know why? Because he lost his faith and trust in the security of God. And he thought, hey, man, I need to find out how many people we got. You know, how strong we are. How strong is this army? But you see here, you know, he said, you know what? It don't matter how strong our army is. Amen?
Yeah.
And guess who found that out in the seven-day war? Yeah. It's a seven-day war, the six-day war. Huh? Six-day war. I knew I had y'all baffled there. It's trying to trick you there. No, it is a six-day war. And, boy, that's another thing to think about. But anyway, we were not going to think there. That's right. And but anyway, man, they found out in a hurry, didn't they? Man, they thought they were going to take care of business, but it didn't happen, did it? You see, because I tell you, folks, you're always in the majority when God is in it.
Amen. Yep.
Amen. It don't matter how big your army is, no matter how big your forces are. Amen. You can, now, folks, listen, there's nothing wrong with a strong military, but it ain't bigger than a strong God.
Yep.
Amen. And so David has learned that God is his deliverer and that God is the one that's going to deliver, that man can do a lot of things. He said, but boy, vain or empty is the help. Now, here again, folks, you can take this scripture out of context if you want to. Doesn't mean that man can't help. It's not what he's talking about, but he's given a comparison here. When it comes to real trouble, real difficulty, man can only take you so far. And really, by the way, men should always lead you to God.
Yeah.
You ought not depend on a man or a woman or somebody else or something else. You need to depend upon God. Amen. Because I tell you, you and I are going to die. Right? Unless Jesus comes back. So our dependence needs to be on God. Amen. And then notice this. I love this because most all the Psalms end with triumph. You know, and it always starts off down and out. And man, it's just like, boy, oh boy, are we ever going to get through this? Are we ever going to get out of it? And then at the end. And folks, listen. What has been consistent in all of it every time is God. He never changes. The situation is still the same. It hasn't gone anywhere. And you say, man, folks, listen, there's some things that I want changed. I want situations changed. But you know what? I can't change them. But you know what? I can look at the unchanging God.
Yeah.
Amen. And know that I can do the same thing David, he says in verse 12, through God we shall do valiantly. For he it is that shall tread down our enemies. You can't fight your own battles. You're going to lose every time. Now, you might win occasionally. But ultimately, you know, I was talking to somebody, and oh, I know who it was. There was in Gatlinburg there at I think we went to a Family Dollar, and they were outside, and they had a cross there, and they were doing things for alcohol addiction and drug addiction, and didn't get to talk to him very long. But anyway, I gave him a little money and he was just talking about what they, you know, represented and did they share the gospel with people and things like that. And they said that they did. And I said, I've talked to many people. It's great if you can get a person off of alcohol and drugs. That's wonderful if somebody we're not against quote unquote AA and them helping people get off of alcohol and drugs. Obviously, that's a good thing, but it's not the best thing. You see, because you can get a person off alcohol and drugs and they can still die and go to hell.
Yeah.
What they need is Jesus. They need true deliverance, right, from alcohol and drugs. But they need real deliverance, amen, from the sin problem that they have in the first place.
Exactly.
Right? Amen.
Yeah.
You see, it's God that delivers. Amen. And David comes to that conclusion. He went from, you see, he went from desertion to deliverance. And in between that, delight. And he thought, God, you're the one that's going to be able to deliver us. The only way out is God. It's not something, someone, or something else. It's God. And so, again, in our 3D message, you know, when it comes to troublesome times, when it comes to the when you feel deserted, you need to turn to God and ask God to turn himself to you. Show himself real in your life and in your heart. And he does that. It's not God that turns, it's us that turn from God. We need God to help us. Amen. And by the way, folks, he's going to deliver us. He's going to deliver us. You know, it might not be today, it might not be tomorrow, it might not. You say, Pastor, I just want to know. I do too. I want to know. You know, we all do. But at the end of the day, you can know this. It will be God that delivers.
Yeah.
We won't be able to deliver ourselves, but God will deliver us. Amen. And good to be in the house of the Lord. Let's stand to our feet and have a word of prayer. No form of invitation. Take these words home and allow God to work in your heart and life. Father, we're grateful for who you are. Thank you, Father, for the message tonight. We pray, dear God, that you would continue to speak as we leave this place. We're glad that your word can continue to speak. And Father, there may be a time this week that we need what we've heard today. And so, Father, we pray that we would put it in the, Barry used to tell us in Bible college, put it on the sticky side of our noodle. And Father, we pray, dear God, that you'd help us with that, that you might be able to use this and draw from it in the future if need be. Father, again, go with us now, and we thank you for letting us be here. We do pray again that you continue to be with all the requests that have been mentioned here tonight. It's in Christ's name we pray, and for his sake. All God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.